I think we have the college basketball title futures. UConn's number one.
I really like Houston. I'd have them winning it all, but you can't be giving Drake jerseys. What is wrong with you?
Maybe the Drake curse is stronger in college basketball.
Well, how long has he been riding with Kentucky?
He wore an Alabama jersey and Saban retired.
The Odds Couple with Rob Fisher, Lang Whitaker, John Roser, and CJ Hurt live Thursdays at 2 p.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
I will take High School Musical with my fifth and final pick because it is a sports movie. You do got to get your head in the game. I love High School Musical. I love musicals. Sports and musicals can coexist in this beautiful world. What a beautiful, beautiful movie. Even though High School Musical 1 is not even the best of the High School Musicals.
Tune in to the Jessica Benson Show with CJ Hurt live every weekday at 8 a.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
There was some sad news coming out of the WWE. Michael Jones, also known as Virgil, passed away. He's a Virginia Union alum, so he graduated from an HBCU. He got his start in Memphis, right?
Oh, man, you're absolutely right. He started in Memphis in 1985.
Get all of your HBCU sports and culture news by tuning in to HBCU Huddle with CJ Hurt and Mike Wallace. New episodes drop every Thursday on GrindCityMedia.com, YouTube, and Spotify.
We know there's only one team you want to watch, and Bally Sports is the place to get your Grizzlies. Experience the comebacks, the buzzer beaters, the can't-miss Memphis-made moments live. Bally Sports keeps the grind going before and after the game, too, with Pete, Brevin, Fish, and Chris on Grizzlies Live. Watch Grizzlies basketball all season long with Bally Sports and streaming on the Bally Sports app. Bally Sports, home of the only team you want to watch.
From the Built Ford Tough Studio at FedEx Forum, it's The Gary Parrish Show, presented by Ortho South, on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app. Now, here's your host, Gary Parrish.
All right. I'm here. My name is Gary Parrish. I'm speaking to you from the Built Ford Tough Studio, FedEx Forum, downtown Memphis. Bennett Doyle right there producing the program. Glad he's with me. Glad you're with me. Hope you're getting through the day best you can. And I hope you don't mind shows that are put together kind of on the fly, because we got big breaking news this morning. OJ Simpson. Dead at the age of 76 after a battle with cancer. He, of course, is one of the most infamous Americans in history. He's a famous football player.
Accurate.
Turned movie star, broadcaster, spokesperson, who then allegedly murdered his ex-wife and a waiter from a nearby restaurant. He was criminally found not guilty, but found liable for those deaths subsequently. We'll talk through all of it as best we can momentarily. First, though, quickly, let me set today's schedule for you. When we finish the open, I'll take a break, come back, and do five more things you need to know, which one we're going to discuss, five previously undiscussed stories. Among them, Scott Drew, Baylor coach, has reportedly passed on the Kentucky job. That happening minutes ago. Where does UK turn next? We'll discuss it in about 20 minutes. The Grizzlies lost last night, but they covered in Cleveland. That wasn't good for you, Big Bet Bennett. Yeah. Funny graphics moment on the broadcast. Only two more games to go. Kings coming to town. We'll talk Grizz in just a bit. WNBA schedule for next season is out, and it's going to be a lot of Caitlin Clark on TV. This is irritating some folks. I'll tell you why that's silly. We'll do it in a third segment. The feds have reportedly concluded that Shohei Ohtani really was in the dark about his interpreter's gambling habits. So that's good news for, I think, first and foremost, Shohei Ohtani, but also Major League Baseball. We'll get into that a little bit more later on in the show. And the first round of the Masters is underway, but we got into a delay. Got into a little bit of a delay.
Yeah, it's gross out there.
It's gross. Look out our window.
It's gross out there.
And it's about the way it looks down in Augusta, Georgia as well. But they're going to play golf today. Tiger Woods going off this afternoon. I'll tell you where we're at. We'll do it during a segment we call Five More Things You Need to Know. Then we'll eventually do GP's carryout and call today. So that's the rundown. We got a lot to get to, but I did want to start with some breaking news from the past hour. Orenthal James Simpson, better known as OJ, he has died at the age of 76 after a battle with cancer. His family announced this morning on social media he had reportedly been diagnosed with cancer in recent years. His health had took a turn for the worse in recent months. The last time he'd posted a video of himself, which he used to do often.
He did that a lot.
Not lately.
No.
He'd been sick, it turns out.
Yep.
February 11th was his last post. It was just before the Super Bowl. 2 months later, April 11th, his family announced he's dead at the age of 76. He, of course, is one of the most infamous Americans in history, a Hall of Fame football player who became a movie star and a broadcaster, internationally known spokesperson before he allegedly killed his ex-wife and a waiter who was at her home in June 1994. It all led to one of the most fascinating television nights in history and arguably the biggest televised criminal trial in American history. Big Bet Bennett?
Yes.
June 17th, 1994 is an important day in history, certainly television history. That's the day of the OJ chase. I know you're a younger fella than I am. Were you old enough to remember the OJ chase?
I don't remember like the specific night, but I'm definitely old enough to remember, and especially the trial afterwards. Like that was, you know, the 90s were different, man. Like
we
didn't have all this stuff.
We didn't have all this stuff.
No. And so like when you want like the info, you go to your TV.
That's right.
And everybody was surrounding those TVs.
That's
man.
Right.
Like TV had a boom in the 90s because of this thing.
You cannot overstate how significant of a moment that was and how wild that entire thing.
Yeah. I think I was in like second grade when the chase happened in 94.
I was in high school. It's June 94, so it would have been the summer before my senior year of high school. But I remember everything about it. I remember where I was. I remember who I was with. Like, I don't remember. Like, I just covered my 21st Final Four.
Mm-hmm.
And if you told me to just name them in order, I have no idea.
Right.
I would not get it right. Now, keep in mind, I flew to all of these cities, stayed in hotels, went to the games, right. Wrote about them, talked about them. I have no recollection of some of them. It'd just be like, you could remind me, and I'd be like, oh, yeah, sure, of course. Mm-hmm. But I'll never forget where I was during that car chase. I'll never forget that moment. Before we get to that,
mm-hmm.
Just some context for people who are too young. It has to be impossible for somebody who didn't live through this to properly grasp what this was in America. Because O.J. Simpson wasn't just a famous football player the way, you know, Odell Beckham's a famous football player.
Right.
O.J. Simpson had transitioned from football stardom into, he was a movie star.
Yes.
And a spokesperson.
USC, California, Hollywood. Yeah.
He was like the face of a lot of different stuff.
Right.
And it I don't mean to overstate it, but like he was Travis Kelce on some level, mm-hmm. in terms of in all the commercials on TV all the time.
Yeah, the Hertz running down the airport. Yeah.
Imagine if you heard today that Travis Kelce might have murdered his ex-girlfriend.
Yeah.
That's what we're talking about here. It's not just that a famous football player was charged with murder. It's like, but that guy?
Yeah.
Now, we subsequently found out a lot about O.J. Simpson that we didn't know. And you got to remember, this is pre-TMZ and pre-everything else. We probably would have thought differently of O.J. Simpson had O.J. Simpson, you know, been living the life he was living then in the 2020s and 2030s, in the era of TMZ and Page Six and
social media.
All that social media.
Right.
But at the time, he was a pretty clean-cut, great reputation.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's interesting is that when you talk to Caitlyn Jenner, formerly Bruce Jenner,
mm-hmm.
who was best friends with OJ, or really anybody who ran in those circles, they all tell you that the second they heard Nicole Brown Simpson had been murdered, they knew it was him.
Damn.
Okay, so yeah. So they knew him in a way that we did not know him. But it was much easier to sort of manipulate the world's perception of you back then because we only had access to so much.
Mm-hmm.
Now, sure, people still have dark secrets. I guess Diddy would be a great example, right?
I think so.
But it's a little harder to hide that stuff these days. So you have to understand that when we hear that Nicole Brown Simpson has been murdered along with a waiter at her home, the first thing America thinks is not, oh my God, OJ Simpson did this. It was like, oh my God, poor OJ.
Right.
The mother of his children. Oh my God, I hope OJ's okay. Because we have no context for the difficulties of their relationship and the abuse within the relationship. Again, some of it was kind of out there in police reports and stuff, but I'm just telling you, as somebody who lived through it all, it wasn't a thing that people talked about. When OJ Simpson popped on TV, it was like, here's OJ Simpson. Look at Juice. Oh man, he looks exactly the way you're supposed to look to be on TV. Sounds exactly the way you're supposed to sound to be on TV. There's OJ Simpson. Everybody loves OJ Simpson. Well, shortly after his ex-wife and Ron Goldman
mm-hmm.
are found murdered in Brentwood, and by murdered, we mean stabbed to death. Nicole nearly decapitated.
Yep.
Gruesome, ugly scene. It became clear that the investigation was zeroing in on O.J. Simpson. And it's like, what? It's still hard to wrap your mind around. Because the only O.J. Simpson you know is the one you see in commercials and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to wrap your mind around that guy showing up with a knife and, I mean, what? But it becomes pretty clear. This is where we're headed. And we get to June 17th, 1994. And at that point, authorities in California make it clear that O.J. Simpson is wanted for the murder of his ex-wife and Ron Goldman, a waiter who we know was returning something to her home. Just sort of like quite literally wrong place, wrong time.
Right.
And it's like, and there were still people in this moment who were like, well, not OJ. Can't be OJ. They might want to talk to him, but it ain't. OJ wouldn't do this like you knew OJ.
Right. Because
you thought you did. You thought you did. That's the way we sort of operated back then. You see somebody on TV, you're like, well, I guess I know that person. And they announce that O.J. Simpson is wanted for the murder of Nicole Brown Simpson and Ron Goldman. But he is also a fugitive at large. He was supposed to turn himself in. He has not done that yet. And right now they are actively looking for O.J. Simpson. At which point, his Bronco is spotted on the freeway in Los Angeles. And what follows is a roughly 45-minute slow-speed chase through Los Angeles that is being broadcast live on network television all throughout the country, interrupting the NBA Finals.
Mm-hmm.
And captivating America. Like if you were alive in that moment and you were in a place that had access to a television in that moment, that's what you were watching in that moment. We had a national championship game on Monday night. Some of us watched it, some of us didn't. The Oscars will come on this year like every year. Some of us will watch it, some of us won't. The Super Bowl even. It's on every year. A whole bunch of us watch it. Some of us don't. There is no scenario on June 17th, 1994, where if you were in a place that had access to a television, you were not watching this. The whole country was watching this thing unfold.
Yeah.
And like I said, I have big moments of my life that I have no recollection of.
Uh-huh.
I guess that's probably true for everybody once you get to a certain age.
Yep.
But I never forget that. I had a friend named Samantha Siebert. Her father lived at South Bluffs.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like the cool dad who, I don't think anybody would mind me telling secrets these days. Like if you wanted to, you know, in high school, go to a house, hang out with your friends and
have a party.
Maybe somebody wouldn't mind so much if you were drinking beers and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
That was going to be Sam's dad.
Yep.
So you got to remember, you know, we're from Horn Lake, Mississippi.
Mm-hmm.
What are we doing? And our friend's dad, he lives at South Bluffs. And he'll like, you know, because I think, I wouldn't want to speak for him, but I think his rationalization would have been, well, they're going to be drinking somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're from Horn Lake, for crying out loud.
Yeah.
They're going to be drinking somewhere.
That's right.
I'd rather
probably in a field.
Yeah, probably in a field with a bonfire.
Yeah.
Definitely in a field with a bonfire.
That's
so
dangerous.
Where you want your kids drinking? In a field with a bonfire? Or in the confines of your own safe space in South Bluffs?
Interesting.
Interesting. You know, tomato, tomato.
To each their own.
To each their own.
Yes.
I'm not sure it's what I'm going to do with my own children, but
TBD for me.
TBD, you know?
TBD for me.
But I can remember appreciating it at the time. I can remember enjoying it at the time. So as I remember it, we were just going to Samantha's dad's house to like watch the NBA Finals on a mm-hmm. Friday night and drink some beers and, you know.
What was it? Knicks?
Rockets.
Knicks Rockets, that's right.
And maybe, you know, maybe you try to hook up, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You might try to, depending on, you know, how the night was going.
Yeah.
But this was a perfect summer night in 1994 for a kid my age. Next thing you know, OJ's on TV in the back of a Bronco. Now, we'd been living with this for a few days
mm-hmm.
and living with this throughout the day because they had announced earlier in the day, like, we looking for OJ.
Yeah, okay.
So it's like, man, they can't find OJ.
Yeah, there was a build-up.
A little bit of a build-up.
Yep.
But you don't, you know, necessarily expect it to go, breaking news, OJ Simpson's white Bronco is in a slow speed chase. Most chases you see are high speed chases, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's a slow speed chase. Like, hey, we just keep following me.
Yep.
I don't really know what I'm trying to do. But we had cameras on the, and people in LA started
getting on the bridges, the overpasses, and holding up signs so he could see them when they drove by.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
The whole thing was unbelievable.
Yep.
And there was a real thought that he was going to kill himself.
Yeah, because wasn't there a cell phone? Which these are rare back in 1994.
He was talking to one of the local news stations.
Yeah, he had a cell phone in the car. Yeah.
And he was
car phone, if
he
you
was
will.
Certainly suggesting
yeah.
that he was going to end his life. And so this whole buildup, because it was clear they weren't trying to get away from the police. They were just avoiding capture for some period of time.
Mm-hmm.
But they weren't trying to escape. It wasn't like, and they're going 130 down the 405.
Right.
It was just like they're just sort of driving and they're just not going to allow OJ to be obtained right now. Presumably because they're trying to figure out what are they going to do?
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to turn yourself in or do you want to take your own life? So imagine Travis Kelce. If this happened tonight, it was like authorities in Kansas City announced this morning Travis Kelce's ex-girlfriend's been found stabbed to death with another dude. And they want to talk to Travis Kelce about it. And next thing you know, they want to charge Travis Kelce with the murder. And now Travis Kelce's in a slow speed chase around L.A. Like, think about how wild that would be. That's what this was.
Mm-hmm.
And then as you're watching it, and the whole thing lasts like 45 minutes, you really don't know. Is Travis Kelce about to go turn himself in? Or is Travis Kelce about to blow his brains out on TV?
Because mm-hmm.
that's where we were. Ultimately, the Bronco ends up...
OJ, you mean? Not Trav.
Well, imagine...
Yeah. Imagining Travis Kelce. I got you.
Ultimately, OJ ends up back at his home. He does just turn himself in. And then the trial of the century, as they say, subsequently begins.
Yep. It was what, C-SPAN? Where were
everywhere.
It? Everywhere. Okay, yeah. I mean, all the networks were carrying it, too.
Again, you can't understand this if you didn't live through it.
Right.
This is what we did for a long time.
Yeah.
We watched a trial and then we discussed it. Mm-hmm. I can't imagine what it'd be like with social media.
Oh, man.
Like, we
need another trial of the century.
We tried with Johnny Depp.
Oh, yeah, we did. That one is big. That one is big.
You can't, like, we all as
there
a country.
There wasn't murder involved.
Yeah, nobody died.
Nobody died.
In that one. But, like, even that one, like, sort of captured us. That was something we were all watching the clips and talking about. That was, like, compared to this thing.
Yep.
It's what we did as a country. Back then, we didn't. You couldn't tweet what you thought about it or post it on Facebook. So you know what we did as a country? We watched this. And then we'd come home.
Face to face, yep.
And then this is what we talk about. Like, whatever it is you talk about when you go home. Hey, how was your day? Hey, how was your day? Hey, what do the kids got going on? Hey, do we have baseball practice tonight? Whatever it is you talk about, this is what we talked about for a long time.
Yeah.
Did you see the thing in the OJ trial today?
See the glove?
Oh, did you see the gloves today?
Yep.
Oh, did you hear that testimony about, oh, wow, could you believe OJ was accused of this and that, whatever?
Yeah.
He consumed us as a people and divided us. Down racial lines. Because if this happened in 2024 as opposed to 1994, he would have been convicted like that.
Yes.
There was so much DNA evidence.
There's just no question.
Like, there's no question that he did this.
Right.
Like, it's like there's no question that it was him, and also nobody else could have. This is easy.
Mm-hmm.
He would be convicted in 4 seconds in 2024. But 2024 was not 1994.
Right.
And as stupid as it sounds now, we just didn't properly understand as a country, certainly as a jury, DNA, how it worked, how reliable it was. And you had things break largely along racial lines. The white community in this country largely believed that O.J. Simpson was guilty. The black community in this country either largely believed he wasn't, or kind of still celebrated a black man beating the system in America because the system had been tilted against minorities in this country forever.
Yeah, and not to mention in L.A. specifically, you're coming off Rodney King. Like, you're coming off some real tension.
So you
in
had
that city. Yeah,
you had some real conflict there. Like, you had some people who were like, "I genuinely don't think he did it. I think they set him up." Because you have to understand where we were as a country, as you pointed out, and where we had been as a country forever.
Mm-hmm.
So like, you would hear things like, "I think they set him up." And if you are a white person from the suburbs, you might be like, come on, cops aren't setting up, huh? But if you're a black person from another place, you might be, hey, man, I've seen it. Cops been setting up people for years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it ain't hard for you to imagine cops setting up people
because
you've been living that, right?
Yeah. And then you had the guy that testified, the one police officer, I can't think of his name.
And he had racist stuff in his background, so that sort of fed into it.
Yep.
And then you had like, well, of course they could have set him up. Look at this guy. He's clearly a racist. When the truth was, yeah, this guy's clearly a racist, but it doesn't mean O.J. Simpson didn't kill these people.
Right, right.
Right? Like, both things could be true at the same time. Yeah, the investigators are racist, but it doesn't mean O.J. Simpson didn't kill these people.
Mm-hmm.
But if you were looking for reasons to absolve O.J. Simpson from this, that one of the lead investigators was clearly caught as a racist, well, that helps you.
Yeah, I do think that, like, the whole Hollywood of it all helped him get acquitted. You know what I mean? Like just the, you're not looking at it as like a, it's almost like you're not looking at the thing as a murder trial back. Like, it's like this, it's a movie playing out in front of you.
It was wild.
Right.
It was.
Yeah.
As you know, I'm sure, ultimately found not guilty.
Right.
Subsequently, more or less admitted to doing it. Like, wrote a book, like a fictionalized version of it. Like, if I did it, here's how I would have done it.
Mm-hmm.
And it is now widely accepted in America and throughout the world that he did kill Nicole Brown, Simpson, and Ron Goldman. He was found civilly liable for their deaths. It's no longer really a debate or a discussion about who was responsible for the deaths of those two people. it was, it's now just sort of accepted that OJ Simpson did that.
Mm-hmm.
And he got away with it for all of the reasons plus some more that I've already detailed.
Mm-hmm.
He was then subsequently imprisoned for a totally separate crime.
Yeah, for the memorabilia kidnapping.
And
kidnapping, yeah.
That was largely seen as like, okay, we couldn't get you here, but you gave us a chance to get you here, so mm-hmm. we're going to get you here.
And in those recordings, because they have the audio of him, you know, in the room with the guy that he thinks stole his memorabilia, and he's got his goons with him, and they're trying to get in. You feel like when you listen to that audio that you can hear like the real OJ.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a different guy.
You can sort of say, yeah. You can go, okay, I can imagine this guy snapping.
Right.
Because by all accounts, that's what happened. He snapped. They had a volatile, he and his ex-wife relationship, an abusive relationship, and he snapped in a way that most of us can't imagine, but he snapped. And there's some, like, I've watched everything on this. I've read everything
no
on
doubt.
This. The Made in America OJ documentary that 30 for 30 did.
So good. That'll do numbers today.
It's amazing. Like, amazing.
We did shows on that.
Like, maybe yeah. the best documentary I've ever seen.
It's by far the best one. ESPN's done a ton of documentaries, and that's
like,
the
in terms
best
of the
one.
ESPN documentaries, it's the Last Dance.
And that one.
And the OJ one.
Yeah.
And I think the OJ one's the best. I think agree. The OJ documentary is the best documentary ESPN's ever done.
I agree.
And one of the best documentaries of all time. It just does an incredible job of first telling the story, but then exploring it through a lens of race and explaining way more eloquently than I can why this divided us among races in this country, the way it did in the 1990s. So absolutely, if you've never seen it, you should watch it. And if you have seen it, you probably won't be bored watching it again. So he was subsequently jailed for the separate case. But then he got out and he had been living, relatively speaking, a normal life in Las Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
Where, like, you just go to the golf course and O.J. Simpson would be there.
Yep.
You'd go to the bar and O.J. Simpson might be sitting, you know, at that table over there.
He's posting videos on social about his fantasy football league. Yeah.
And it was just, people didn't really know, like, how did you ever, I don't want to say I often wondered about this because that would be not true. But I did, like, because you see these pictures sometimes of, like, selfies and people are getting selfies with O.J. Simpson.
Right.
And you know how that has to work. Somebody has to spot O.J. Simpson and then go,
hey, can I get a picture? Yeah.
Like, would you want a selfie with O.J. Simpson? Or even, like, to flip it around, if for whatever reason O.J. Simpson wanted a selfie with you,
yeah.
would you take one? If you walked at a bar
uh-huh.
and saw O.J. Simpson, well, that'd be crazy because he's dead. He shouldn't even be in a bar.
Yeah.
But, like, I mean before this.
Yep.
Like 2 years ago, you walk in a bar and you see O.J. Simpson.
Mm-hmm.
How you acting, Big Bud Bennett?
I'm going to be honest. Like, I don't, I think it's wrong, but I probably would be one of those people asking for a selfie too.
Yuck.
And here's why. Like, in its heart, and I think this is what all those people that got selfies, that, you know, talked to him in public, that just wanted to interact with him. I think it goes back to what I said about the whole Hollywood of it all. Like, you almost look at it like it's not real.
Except it is real.
Except
woman,
it is
a
real.
Woman got
I know.
Throat.
I know.
It
you
is real.
You look at it as it's like a movie.
A young man lost his life.
Out. I know.
Wrong place, wrong time, nothing more.
I completely agree. And I feel ashamed to say that, but yeah, I think I probably would be a person that asked for a selfie.
Like
yes.
this man O.J. Simpson, he with his own hands took two people's lives and then like beat it and would like show up at the Kentucky Derby. He'd just be at the Kentucky Derby.
Yep.
And we are looking at this guy like he's responsible for the murder, not the accidental death. This wasn't like he was drinking and driving and had a car accident or,
no.
you know, which would still be awful but different.
Yep.
This was like he went to his ex-wife's house and he murdered her.
Mm-hmm.
And now he's right there at the Kentucky Derby. It's crazy.
One of those things that always stands out to me with that, when it all went down is and they point this out in the documentary and you've seen people talk about it a ton, but when he takes that phone call that she's dead and what did he said, do he said, do they know who did it?
This was the first red flag the investigators
Yes.
Because if you remember, he was in Chicago. Uh-huh. He flew to Chicago for some memorabilia thing or some appearance that he had to make. And so the timeline of all this is he kills Nicole and Ron at night, and he's got to fly to Chicago the next morning.
Mm-hmm.
So by the time the bodies are discovered and they're calling next of kin, he's already in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
They get in touch with him. And they said, like, there were other red flags, like he had cuts on his hands. Like, that's...
Yeah.
That's a red flag. Like, look at my... I don't have any cuts on my hands.
Right, no.
You know why?
It didn't kill someone.
I didn't kill somebody last
night.
With
my hands, yeah.
With my... Or, yeah, I didn't kill any... I just want the record. I didn't kill anybody anyway last night. Or ever, anytime. I want that on the record. But they said the first real red flag was... Because these people make these phone calls. It ain't the first time they ever made this phone call. They know how people react.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like if you're a doctor, like I wouldn't know how to tell somebody you've been diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't know how to do that. I would dread that moment.
Sure.
You know you're about to tell somebody something that's going to absolutely break them, right? How do you do that? But doctors do it every day. There's a doctor doing it right now. And I promise you that doctor who's doing it right now, he or she, they've done it before.
Mm-hmm, they know,
and they know how to do it. And yep. and they know how people react to this news. They know exactly what it's going to look like. Not that you ever get numb to it. I don't know if you do,
mm-hmm.
but like you do become conditioned to like, I know how this is going to go. I know what I'm going to say. I know how they're going to respond. I know what they're going to ask. I know what I'm going to say. I know what they're going to ask next. Yeah. I know what I'm going to say. We've been through this a lot. So they know how this is supposed to go, right?
Yep.
They call OJ Simpson. And they say, Mr. Simpson, just wanted to, you know, regret, you know, to have to tell you. Sorry to have to tell you. But your ex-wife, Nicole, has been found dead. What they explained is when you tell somebody that, the first thing they always say, if it's an abrupt death, an unexpected death, when you tell somebody died, the first thing they always say is how.
Mm-hmm.
God forbid. But if somebody called you right now and said that somebody you care about deeply has passed and you weren't expecting this, the first thing you would ask is, how?
Yes.
Your mind would be going any... what?
Yeah,
how?
What happened? Yeah.
You might first express shock and surprise, but very quickly you get to what happened. And he never asked him what happened. They said that was one among the first red flags. He didn't ask us how.
Mm-hmm.
And the only reason somebody wouldn't ask you how their ex-wife died abruptly, unexpectedly... The only reason somebody wouldn't ask you is if they already know.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't even occur to ask. Naturally, your instincts are to, if you don't know something, ask why, particularly something like this. So why wouldn't you ask, why did this happen? How did this happen? Because you already know.
Mm-hmm.
When he didn't say, what? How? What happened? This is a very weird conversation.
Yeah.
And that put the antennas up. And then, of course, all the evidence takes them right where it took them. But I don't know if we'll ever live through something like that again.
No, I don't
think so. I mean, I guess I hope we don't. No, I guess I hope we don't.
Of course not. I think it's we won't. I don't. Maybe. I don't know. The ones that stand out to me are that one. I'm around the same, you know, period, the Princess Diana. Obviously, 9/11.
Well, of course, but those were just moments and like those were just big tragic moments, yeah. Like the Challenger.
Yeah, but where everything stopped.
Well, sure, the Challenger explosion, 9/11, Princess Di. I mean, you know, there's the Michael Jackson death, the Prince death. These are just like a Kobe Bryant.
Sure, Kobe.
These are all things, but those things come and go. Like 9/11 happens, and it, you know, obviously, if you were impacted, your family was impacted by that, it's with you forever. Rebuilding New York City took years.
Mm-hmm.
but that moment doesn't consume us forever. It's something we remember forever, but it's not something that consumes our life every day for years at a time. The OJ Simpson thing consumed us for years. First the murder, then the arrest, or then the chase, then the arrest, then the trial, then the verdict. It was all a part of our daily lives for an extended period of time. Like people skipped school to watch certain aspects of this. It was unlike anything we'd ever seen. And given that the way we consume media and news now is so different than we used to do it, I don't know that we'll ever have a television moment like that again, because we don't have TVs like we had then. Mm-hmm. Now, if that same thing happened, we would all just circles watching it all on our phone, as opposed to gathered around in Times Square or any bar in America or anything else you were.
Right.
We would consume it all differently. And it'd be wild still. But the whole thing was just, you can't wrap your head around this is what's happening in this country right now. And the way we were all pulled into that and the way that we were pulled into it. It really was I don't want to say a special moment in American history, because that's not the way to say it. Mm-hmm. But it was a unique moment in American history, and certainly a unique moment in television history. And I guess that's how you do 35 minutes down memory lane
to open
a show when you found
that's
out like
wild,
10 minutes right before it started that O.J. Simpson had died. But that's certainly the big story, big news of the day. O.J. Simpson dead at 76 after a brief battle with cancer. We come back, we'll turn our attention to basketball stuff. Kentucky's still looking for a coach, and that's because Scott Drew has decided he's going to stay at Baylor and not go to UK. Where do the Wildcats turn next? We'll discuss it right after this break. Gary Parrish Show, presented by Ortho South.
It's more fun to be there live to see the Memphis Grizzlies hit the court all season long. From the electricity in FedEx Forum to the highlight reel plays, there's nothing quite like Grizzlies basketball. As the official marketplace of the Memphis Grizzlies, Ticketmaster gets you in with a huge selection of seats. So get off the couch and into the stands while you still can. Score tickets today at Ticketmaster.com. That's Ticketmaster.com.
Maxwell in concert. The Serenade Tour. October 16th at FedEx Forum. Maxwell. With special guest Jasmine Sullivan. And October London. Tickets on sale now at LiveNation.com. You don't miss Maxwell Live.
Nate Bargatze, the Be Funny Tour.
I mean, Chuck E. Cheese is rough. I don't know if you've been there in a while. They look like they're trying to go to business and they can't.
All new material.
They filed for bankruptcy and they're still open. They called Blockbuster and they're like, how do you get out? We want out.
Nate Bargatze, Friday, May 31st, FedEx Forum. Tickets available at FedEx Forum Box Office or Ticketmaster.com. Produced by Outback Presents. Nate Bargatze, the Be Funny Tour.
We know there's only one team you want to watch, and Bally Sports is the place to get your Grizzlies. Experience the comebacks, the buzzer beaters, the can't-miss Memphis-made moments live. Bally Sports keeps the grind going before and after the game, too, with Pete, Brevin, Fish, and Chris on Grizzlies Live. Watch Grizzlies basketball all season long with Bally Sports and streaming on the Bally Sports app. Bally Sports, home of the only team you want to watch.
Don't worry, Be Fluffy World Tour.
The minute you get into a brand new relationship, like magic, you know who really notices just how happy you are, guys? Other women, not your woman.
Look how happy he is.
I bet I can change that.
Friday, May 10th, FedEx Forum. Get your tickets now at FluffyGuy.com. Don't miss a Memphis. Don't worry, be Fluffy World Tour.
He's looking for the hot hand. Jaren got the step, got the flush. There's no layups on that one.
Electric, rowdy, intense. They bring the same mentality that they bring anywhere into the building. If they were mad about something, they're bringing it in. If they were happy about something, they're bringing it in. So we need all that energy times a thousand.
Unpredictable, unforeseen, and unscheduled, and Ortho South understands this better than anyone. Since your injuries don't make appointments, you don't need to either. That's because Ortho South welcomes walk-ins during the weekdays and the evenings, and even on Saturday. So next time an unforeseen injury makes an unscheduled appearance in your life, visit orthosouth.org to find your nearest urgent care location. Just walk in, and Ortho South will take care of everything, especially you. Learn more at orthosouth.org. That's Ortho South. At orthosouth.org, now I got five more things you need to know.
Number one.
Scott Drew is reportedly turned down. Kentucky's going to remain the head coach of the Baylor Bears, so it's another swing and a miss for UK at this point among the obvious candidates. Jay Wright, Dan Hurley, Nate Oates, and now Scott Drew have indicated they're not going to be the next head coach of the Kentucky Wildcats. So that's at least four people that were sensible candidates for UK that have made it clear they're not going to be the next coach at UK. Is it panic time in Lexington, Big Bet Bennett? Or are they still going to land in a good spot if they just see this thing through?
I think it might be panic time if you want the hire to be a huge splash. Yeah. Now, is it panic time as far as getting a good coach? No.
Right.
But, yeah, I think as far as, like, big splash, massive name, yeah, you're getting – that list is getting small. Yeah.
I would – if I were them, I'd just hit pause right now.
Mm-hmm.
I'd just hit pause.
You don't want to mess up.
I'd take a breath.
Yep.
And I would say we're waiting on Billy Donovan, and he's going to have to tell us no. Or I would already be working behind the scenes and making sure before we move on that Billy Donovan 100% will not be the next head coach at the University of Kentucky. Billy is still in the middle of an NBA season. He's going to be in the postseason with the Chicago Bulls. Mm-hmm. But they are probably going to be in the first play-in game in the Eastern Conference, meaning – their season could be over this weekend.
Yeah.
Like it's not this weekend, but soon.
Yeah, in 2 weeks, yep.
Well, it's not even 2 weeks.
No, it's not even 2 weeks.
I mean, the playing game's April 16th, the first playing game. So.
And they are not getting in the playoffs.
No.
There's no way.
So, I mean, their season could reasonably be over in less than a week. Don't you just wait it out at this point?
Mm-hmm.
Or at least before you move on, you just have to know. Like if I'm Mitch Barnhart and if somebody asks me privately and we go and hire somebody besides Billy Donovan and somebody asks me privately, Mitch, was Billy Donovan an option? I want to be able to say, oh, we pursued that and mm-hmm. we were willing to wait on him and he knew that. We told him that we don't need anything from him until he's done with the Chicago Bulls season. But when the Chicago Bulls season is over, will you accept this offer to come be the next head coach of the University of Kentucky? And he told us he was not interested in doing that. So we moved on. But unless I hear that from Billy Donovan, I'm not moving on at this point. If you could get Dan Hurley instead of Billy Donovan, fine. And if you could get Nate Oates instead of Billy Donovan, I would have done that. Jay Wright instead of Billy Donovan, sure. Scott Drew in front of Billy Donovan, I would have done that. But I think we've reached the point now where whatever you do next is going to be a little bit of a reach. It's not going to be obvious to to anybody whatever you do next is, other than if it's Billy Donovan. And that's why I would make him tell me no. And I, you know, ready for this? I'm not sure that he was going to tell you no. I already see some people moving off of it. Some of the same college basketball reporters who a week ago were saying, oh, if the Kentucky job opened, or even 2 days ago, if the Kentucky job opens, Billy's not going to do it. Don't even bother asking Billy. Some of them are now even going, well, you know, maybe. Because just common sense, if you're Billy Donovan, how much longer has he got in Chicago?
It can't be. There. I mean, you would think they're close to hitting a reset, right?
He's going nowhere.
It's going absolutely nowhere, yeah.
It's going nowhere this year. Like, they're good. He's good enough to not get fired, but not good enough to go anywhere.
Right.
Well, eventually those guys get fired.
Yes.
So how much longer do you have in Chicago? Let me tell you the same reason Billy Donovan might take the Kentucky job if you offer it to him. It's the exact same reason John Calipari just took the Arkansas job. Because how much longer do you have at Kentucky?
Mm-hmm.
John Calipari didn't take the Arkansas job because he loves Northwest Arkansas, or because he loves Tyson Foods, or because they have more money than Kentucky, or because it's a better situation than Kentucky. The only reason he took the Arkansas job is because how much longer do you have at Kentucky?
Right.
You can keep this job. We're not going to fire you now, but do this again, and we will. So then where are you at? John's options were stay on the hot seat at Kentucky, maybe get fired after next year, or take a brand new challenge at Arkansas with fresh expectations, fresh fan base, all of that stuff. End of the day, pretty easy decision. Why is Billy Donovan's decision much different than that? Yeah, if it was picking between being the next head coach year one of the Chicago Bulls, like, it's just two jobs are on the table, you're unemployed. You want to coach the Chicago Bulls or the Kentucky Wildcats? Maybe then you go Chicago Bulls.
Mm-hmm.
But what if you're not in year one anymore? You're just coming off of another whatever year, and if you have another whatever year, it might be the end of you. Or you could go be the coach of what most people will tell you is the best job in college basketball.
Yeah.
And among the reasons Billy got out of college basketball to begin with, there was a lot, but I'm on the list somewhere, is because he got fed up with the way recruiting worked. He got tired of being a slave to recruiting. The idea that he has to show up at grassroots games at all hours of the day, all throughout the summer, take phone calls nonstop, be on Zooms nonstop, or whatever the equivalent of Zooms were when Billy was a coach. Like, the idea that he had to continue to do that, to work in that way, to be a successful high-major coach, just sort of like it wasn't fun for him anymore. Without exception, when you talk to a NBA coach who used to work in college, the one thing they will always tell you is that they prefer the NBA because it's just basketball. They just coach their teams. That's all they have to do. They don't have to recruit, deal with boosters, deal with academic people. When I remember the first time Brad Stevens came through here as head coach of the Celtics, I went to the game. I met with him after the game. We talked for a few minutes. He was getting his brains beat in that first year in Boston. They were losing a lot. And I remember him saying something like, I've already lost more games this season than I lost my entire time at Butler. Like, the losing is getting to me. This is not fun. But I remember him also saying, but all I do is watch film, coach my team. That's it. Like, at Butler or at any other college job, you watch you coach your team, you watch film, you have a game. Then after the game, you got to host recruits in your office, talk to some parents, make some phone calls on your way home. It never stops. He didn't like that anymore.
Mm-hmm.
The NBA is a preferable lifestyle. But now, because of name, image, and likeness, and we talked about this before, and transfer waivers, recruiting is much more transactional. It's much more like NBA free agency. You don't have to be the first one to offer anymore. Like, that used to be a thing. You know, oh, I've been recruiting him since he was in eighth grade. You don't have to do that anymore. You know, when NBA free agency starts, you know what teams do? They don't rely on 3 years of recruiting. You know what they say? Here's what we can offer. Do you want that? Can anybody else offer that? If not, you're probably coming with us. Sometimes people take less money to be in a specific situation, but for the most part, NBA free agency, people take the best contracts they can get.
Mm-hmm.
Why do you think Chandler Parsons played in Memphis, Tennessee? It ain't because he dreamed of living on the Mississippi River. It's because the Grizzlies offered him a contract that nobody else would offer him. So he said, grit and grind, let's go. Simple as that. That's the way college basketball recruiting is going to start working. It's already working that way to some degree. My point being, at a place like Kentucky, it's no longer important to be at all these grassroots games and talk to all these AAU coaches and consume yourself with stuff that you'd rather not be consumed with. You know what you have to do at the University of Kentucky? If you're Billy Donovan, probably fly into the hometown of whoever the number one transfer portal prospect is. Introduce yourself as Billy Donovan, two-time national champion, new head coach of the Kentucky Wildcats, used to work in the NBA. Young man at Kentucky, we'd really like to have you. I know I just met you. What's your mom's name again? Here's $1 million I can guarantee you to come play at Kentucky for me. You interested? Okay, we're done then. Recruiting success accomplished. That's it. That's all it takes. You don't have to put in all the legwork anymore.
Right.
So if you got out of college basketball because you got tired of all the work that it took to recruit, isn't this the time to get back in?
I think so.
You don't have to do that anymore. Mm. You just have to show up with the money. So I understood when Billy left Florida why he did it. His options were to continue to coach in a sport that he no longer enjoyed everything that went hand in hand with it, or go be the head coach in Oklahoma City of a young, amazing core. That makes perfect sense.
Yep.
But now what are his options? What will his options be in a week if Kentucky will just wait on him? What will be his options? To continue to coach an Eastern Conference franchise that is going nowhere.
Right.
Just sort of stuck in the middle. And probably you don't even get to do that much longer.
Right.
Because once you stay stuck in the middle too long, somebody says, well, it's time to just blow the whole thing up. And boom, they start with you. All right? So that's option one. Or, in the era of name, image, and likeness, go coach the biggest and best basketball program in America. That actually is an easy decision for me. I don't want to speak for Billy, but I think it'd be an easy decision for me. So if I'm Kentucky now, I just hit pause. And I'd turn my attention privately to Billy Donovan. But how about this? If you don't hear Kentucky has a coach within the next 2 or 3 days, it's Billy Donovan.
Yeah.
If they don't wrap this thing up quickly with a Bruce Pearl or a TJ Otzelberger or a Mark Pope or something like that, if you're like, man, this is sort of dragging out, then it's going to be Billy Donovan, and they're just waiting on Billy Donovan. So Scott Drew's staying at Baylor. Kentucky's still looking for a coach. John Calipari in Arkansas trying to rebuild. It's a wild time in college basketball. We'll keep you updated.
Number two.
Grizzlies lost last night, but they did cover, Bennett.
Oh, my God. And you know what is outrageous about that is they were down more than 20, like, late in that game.
Late run got you.
The late run got me.
Bennett, do you know what your record is right now?
I don't even want to know.
I know you don't want to know, but do you know?
No.
You're now 100, 111, and 4. You're down 23.1 units.
Mm.
It's a low point for you.
You know, I should have taken into account when the game started, it was close for a lot of the first half. You had that lineup, and it was Gigi, Scottie Pippen, Stevenson, Trey Jemison. You had Jake LaRavia, who had a huge game, and they were competitive for most of that first half. And then, like, you obviously get the, you know, the guys that haven't been here, and then it gets away from them, and they get down 20. But then Jenkins put those guys back in, and they've all five been playing together for a minute. And so I should have taken into account, okay, Jenkins has five guys he can put out there that have been playing together for a minute. And typically the Grizzlies, they can compete in those situations. Like, Jenkins is a good coach. I should have taken that into account. I didn't take into account that we had five guys that could all play together, that had been together, that could keep this thing close. And it screwed me again.
You failed yourself.
I played myself.
You excited about Jake LaRavia, or you don't even care?
Oh, no. Listen, Jake's going to be on this team next year. So I'm glad that we're seeing something. I don't know what it means, because you look at the Grizzlies' depth going into next season, you know, where does he fit? He's probably like maybe the 10th, 11th guy at best.
The problem becomes, you say he is going to be on the team this season unless he's traded.
Right.
But like the problem about getting excited about Jake LaRavia, and last night he was 10 of 18 from the field, 8 of 11 from 3, 32 points, whatever. The problem with getting excited about Jake LaRavia is that if he is on this team next season, the only way he plays is if
somebody gets hurt.
Is if just stuff has gone wrong again.
Right. That's right.
Right? So, like, I don't even know. I don't know that I care that much.
Yeah, I mean, there's something to always, you know, what do you want at the end of your bench? Like, you want shooting, right? So, if he could come in and knock down 4 3-pointers in a game that maybe some guys are out, then, yes, that's something that you want. On your team. But I agree with you, like, as far as like massive contributor next season, I don't know if I necessarily see that.
He was 8 of 11 from 3 last night. He's always been described as a shooter. Here's the problem. He's never shot it well.
Right.
He's the classic shooter who doesn't make shots.
He is lately.
He did lately. Hey, 8 of 11 last night, but still career 33.3% 3-point shooter.
Yeah.
Like, he's a shooter, but through 2 years in the NBA, he hasn't made shots at that level. How you deal with that?
Well, I mean, he's also
at what point are you like, you're just a guy who looks like you should be a shooter, but you don't actually make them?
I agree. I mean, he's also dealt with injuries, so we haven't really seen him play a full season. So I don't know, man. I'm cautiously optimistic.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll allow you to be that way. Jake LaRavia had a big night. 2 games left to go. King coming to town tomorrow night. Lakers have something to play for.
Oh, let's go.
I wish we could get a definitive, like, LeBron James is playing.
He's playing in this game.
There's no reason for him not to.
No.
Other than he's old.
No, but you're in playoff mode right now if you're the Lakers.
Yeah.
You got to be. I mean, you don't want that 10 seed.
I believe that our king will play tomorrow night inside FedEx Forum. I believe if you come downtown tomorrow night.
Yeah.
You're going to get to see the king.
I think you're right.
I think you're going to see the king play
basketball.
I think
you're going to see the king, too. That's a good way to kind of finish out the season.
Hey, it's the last weekend of the season.
Yep.
Let's go see the king.
Well, and the other thing, too, is on Sunday afternoon when the Nuggets get in here, I think they will play as well because they get the win or the big game last night over the Timberwolves, battle for the one seed. But you can still lose that pretty easily. You got to play this thing out. And the fact that they tried to win that game last night shows that they definitely want that one seed. Like, they could have, because there's obviously posturing you can do, matchups that you like better in the playoffs and whatnot, but it's pretty clear the Nuggets want the one seed, so they're going to have to play it out on Sunday. So you get to see Jokic too, probably.
Maybe the greatest player of all time and maybe the greatest player of current times inside FedEx Forum this weekend.
That ain't a bad way to finish out a season, GP.
There are better ways.
Of course there are, but in the situation we're in now.
In the situation we're in now, it's not a bad way to close out the season.
Oh, did you see, Kyra, do we have the picture, the image from the game last night?
Hmm.
Did you see this on the broadcast last?
Oh, yeah.
There's the Grizzly season right there in a nutshell.
That's Timmy Allen. But they didn't know.
They did Timmy wrong. Come on, man.
That's just a graphics failure.
It's just a graphics
there's
failure.
A funny
no
one,
big deal.
There's a funny one of Wally Zerbiak from way back in our CSTV days. Uh-huh. Before we were CBS Sports Network, it was CSTV.
Mm-hmm.
And Wally worked there. Wally's been a part of the family for a long time. I think he even predates me, at least on the television side. And it's exactly like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like if it shows me on TV, same graphic, Gary Parrish,
yeah.
CBS Sports, whatever. And it says, I think you could just Google it. Let me see. I want to make sure I get it right. Wally Zerbiak. I think it says random dude.
No, it does not.
Yeah. Just Google Wally Zerbiak and random dude. It'll pop right up. Kyra, see if you can Google that. Wally Zerbiak, random dude. And it'll just pop right up and you'll see a young Wally Zerbiak on Inside College Basketball. I guess it was CBS College Sports at the time. So before it was CBS Sports Network, it was CBS College Sports. But yeah, it's just like the Timmy Allen one, except in rather than say Wally Zerbiak, it says random dude. Look here.
Oh my. How do you even get that? Somebody was messing with him.
No, what happens is you're just putting placeholders into graphics.
That, okay.
And you shouldn't put random dude because somebody will just glance at that and feel like you should put like X's or, you know, weird.
Or question marks. Question, like
exactly what
Timmy
they were trying to do.
Yes.
Those question marks should indicate to somebody this needs to be filled in.
Yes.
Somebody failed.
Right.
Somebody didn't do their job so well. But with Wally, like somebody was just like, we need a, that'll be called like a lower third. It'll be like, yeah, we need a lower third. Who's it going to be? I don't know. Just random dude.
Former NBA player.
I know. And then they, but then.
Former All-Star, right?
I know. But I bet you when they made that random dude graphic, they didn't know who the guest was going to be at the time.
I got you.
So they were like, we need a lower third for our guest. Who's it going to be? Not sure yet. Okay, just put random dude here. I'll update it. Then they forget to update it. Next thing you know, you got Wally Szczerbiak on TV being described as a random dude.
That's tough.
Yeah. Graphics department. It's a tough business.
Yeah, it is.
You know what? People only notice them when they're wrong.
That's true. I know. That ain't fair.
Think of how many times you've seen a shot of a basketball player, and it's got his names and his points and his rebounds underneath it, and you never even blinked, right?
Mm-hmm.
But then they do that to Timmy Allen. You can't stop talking about it.
Right.
That's the life of a graphics designer.
Seems like it.
That's the life of a graphics designer. Nobody knows. Nobody even notices when you're doing your job well. Oh, but buddy, you put some question marks in there. Now Big Bet Bennett can't stop talking about you.
Yeah.
That's the life of a graphics designer, Bennett. That's not an easy life.
No.
It's just like those buttons, you know?
Trust me, I know.
I don't notice when you hit them right.
But when it's wrong, very noticeable.
You see what I'm saying?
All right.
You know what that's like.
I know.
And you wanted to shine a negative light on that graphic design.
I just thought the picture was funny.
It was funny.
It was funny.
It was
funny. It was making the rounds.
We have reached the point where like people really don't even know who's on the Grizzlies.
I mean, that's what happens when you have a historical number of players on your team.
We should never do this again.
Never. I'd never want to do it again.
I'd like to never do this again.
But the problem with that is I feel like we've done it more than any other franchise in the NBA in the history of the league, because I think we held the previous record, maybe.
What are we doing?
Or we were up there in that top five.
Why are we always so hurt?
Yeah, yeah. Let's not do this next year.
Yeah, let's never do this again. Anyway, Grizzlies lost. But they did cover. They showed some heart, little 10-day Grizzly hearts.
Mm-hmm.
We get their hearts 10 days at a time. They showed some heart, 10-day hearts. Two more games to go. Go Grizz.
Go Grizz, baby.
Go Grizz.
Number three.
WNBA television schedule's coming out. Oh, people are upset.
Are they?
Oh.
I bet it's because of Caitlin.
Oh, she always making people mad.
Polarizing figure.
Why is she so polarizing?
I don't know.
I don't know either.
I really
she seems like a nice
know,
young
to be
woman.
Quite honest.
Why do people hate Caitlin Clark?
Yeah, I don't know.
People so mad. Why are people so mad at Caitlin Clark?
That one's confusing.
So Caitlin Clark, as you know, Ben, as you know,
mm-hmm.
Indiana Fever had the number one pick in the WNBA draft.
Okay,
they're going to use it on Caitlin Clark. So when the WNBA TV schedule comes out, guess who has more games on national television next year than any other WNBA franchise?
It's got to be your Indiana Fever.
The Indiana Fever and apparently the Las Vegas Aces and their
fans. Oh, because they're awesome.
Because they're awesome.
Oh, you mean, I thought you were going to say they have the second most.
They do.
They do, okay.
Yeah, but they say, why are we not have the first most?
I mean, fair question. The Aces are awesome.
Except the
People
answer.
People love the Aces.
The answer would be, you ready for this?
Yeah.
You ready for the answer?
Yep.
Because you don't have Caitlin Clark.
That's true.
Because Caitlin Clark's the television draw, and you don't have her. It's a little bit like when New Orleans had all those games on national television in Zion's rookie year.
Yep, yep.
Now, that didn't work out so well, nope. But the idea behind it was...
It's Zion.
We just watched this guy be a ratings monster at Duke. We're going to assume he's going to be a ratings monster in the NBA. So we're going to put him on TV a lot. It doesn't really matter to us. In Memphis, if you guys think you deserve more games than them because you've been winning more than them. They have Zion and you don't. They get on TV and you don't. This is similar, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is just another example of television networks doing what's smart for television networks and then everybody else thinking that, you know, it should be more of an equal opportunity endeavor. Like the Aces are the champs. They should be on TV more than anybody else. Well, what if they're not the biggest TV draw? You know who used to go through this all the time?
Mm.
San Antonio Spurs.
Yep. Best team in basketball.
Nobody wanted to watch them.
Right.
So they didn't get like, yeah, best team in basketball, but we're going to put LeBron's team on TV.
Yeah, we're going to put Kobe on. Yep.
Right.
Yep.
Best. You're the best team in basketball, but people like watching Kobe.
Yep.
So we're going to put Kobe on TV. That's all this is. Everybody respects the Aces. But like this Caitlin Clark thing, who knows whether it's actually going to work? Do you have an opinion on that? Is she going to make people watch the WNBA?
I think for sure, just off of, because the season starts pretty quickly, right? Like it's not, there's a pretty quick turnaround with this, way quicker than the NBA. Yeah. Like this thing will start.
Oh, there's not even like a WNBA combine. Like I work with Renee Montgomery, who owns the Atlanta Dream.
Mm-hmm.
And we were together at the Final Four. And Renee was like, because I was just sort of picking her brain about it. She's like, oh no, like, you know, like the season's over and then it's time to go. It's like, it's time to get drafted.
Yep.
Like the draft is like whenever, soon. And like, so there's no combine? No, we don't have combine. Like you don't, like at most, you'll bring in somebody and maybe have dinner with them. But the idea that you get to go through a whole process the way they do in the NBA,
yeah,
it's just not like that. So it all happens pretty quickly.
Yeah, so I think you're gonna get the initial buzz, obviously, of Caitlin, you know, being in the WNBA now. So yes,
you know what I think it's gonna be like?
You're gonna get early eyeballs for sure.
I think it's gonna be like Messi in MLS in the sense that when she plays, it'll be like, oh, Caitlin Clark's on TV tonight. It'll be one of those deals. Mm-hmm. But it won't necessarily make you watch the New York Liberty against the Atlanta Dream.
Mm-hmm.
But if Caitlin Clark is playing against the New York Liberty, you might turn that on. I think that's where this is going to be. Like, I don't know how many new MLS fans there are because of Messi, but undeniably, Messi became a thing and people watched that.
Like, that's coming back, right?
Oh, yeah. Like he's.
Are we going to have another summer of Messi?
Yeah, I think he played last night.
Oh, it's just on the back burner right now.
Yeah, because it was something else. But, like, I know that.
All right, man. Well, I need you to get ready for this because your Mets ain't doing nothing.
They're in. I know this because I was on radio in Kansas City Tuesday.
Yeah,
and I just know from talking to Sorrento there, they were preparing for Messi to come to Kansas City. But like, here's the deal: Messi's in Kansas City either like, you know, today or tomorrow or this weekend or sometime soon.
Yeah,
and they moved that to Arrowhead Stadium, right?
Yeah.
Now they're not moving all of Sporting KC. Is that the name? They're not moving all their matches to Arrowhead Stadium, but they moved that one because of Messi. I think that'll be the Caitlin Clark thing. She'll make people watch her and her team, but I don't know how much it's going to resonate all throughout the WNBA. But either way, they're going to put her on TV more than anybody else. That's the schedule announcement from last night. I wish them luck.
Number four.
Shohei Ohtani. The feds have more or less concluded their investigation into the scandal involving gambling and his former interpreter. And the feds are now of the belief that Shohei Ohtani really did not know that his interpreter was gambling on sports and stealing money from him to cover his losses. Do you buy it?
No.
No.
Well, no, I think that Shohei paid his friend to fall on the sword.
Maybe. But wouldn't the feds be able to figure that out? The feds good at figuring stuff out?
They're pretty good at figuring stuff out. But Shohei's been able to keep a lot private. He's good at concealing things.
I just think if he really did know, they would be able to prove that at the very least with some incredible circumstantial evidence. And I mean, because they're looking at all his devices.
That's true.
Everything.
That's true.
And I just think if you are really involved in any way with covering up your interpreter's gambling losses, there would be some digital evidence that incriminates you that the feds would have access to. I mean, that's how they get all these murders. I mean, you can't get through one episode of Dateline without them. I mean, everybody.
Yeah, it all comes back to the phone. Yep.
It's your phone, your computer.
Yep.
So, do we really think Shohei Ohtani is so reckless that he could? Do we think he was so careful that he could actually be involved in sports gambling and or covering losses for his interpreter without leaving any electronic evidence at all? I just don't think so.
Maybe not.
I think the most likely scenario is he was just in the dark. Because I imagine when you have that kind of money, it'd be very easy for somebody you really trust to get access to it.
Right.
And you don't even notice that it's gone.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, you have to understand the type of money we're talking about here. It sounds crazy to be like, stole millions of dollars. Like, how could you not notice that $2 million is missing?
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you have $200 million, like, do you know right now to the dollar how much money you have in your checking account?
Yes.
Okay.
It ain't that much to keep up with, bro. Okay.
Never mind, man. Oh, here's my point. When you have as much money as Shohei Ohtani and you're missing just a little bit, mm-hmm. it's not crazy for me to go, I could see how he would not even notice that is gone. I could see how he might not notice that's gone. And the other thing is to me even more clear. If he was really covering up or involved, there would be some electronic evidence somewhere. There just yeah. would be. There just would be. They'd be able to show you something like, this payment was made at this time, and at that exact time, Shohei Ohtani was on this website, on this computer. Like, it just seems like they would. I can't imagine he was so careful that he could have actually not left a fingerprint digitally somewhere. So I'm gonna assume this is true, that Shohei Ohtani, it really is a victim here. And if I end up looking stupid, then I end up looking stupid.
Mm.
But I think Shohei Ohtani, it appears that he's a victim. And his interpreter, former interpreter, oh, buddy, he's going to face some real serious stuff now.
He's in trouble. Yeah, he's in trouble.
Should have been more careful.
Yeah.
Number five.
Masters is underway. Better late than never, huh?
It is underway.
Guess who's your early leader?
It's Bryson.
DeChambeau.
Is Bryson going to be the dude?
He's 3 under through three.
That power runs out.
No, it doesn't.
The power runs out.
No, it doesn't. It actually won't. That will not be his problem. Power will not be his power or lack thereof will not be his problem. His problem could come on the greens or any number of places. But he's 3 under through three. So, you know what? That's a nice start.
Yeah, I placed all my bets yesterday.
You didn't have Bryson in any of them?
Nope.
I didn't have him.
Not a one.
In the Masters, here's the thing. I don't know if I'm allowed to place bets. So if I'm not allowed to place bets, then I didn't place any.
Yeah, I got you.
But if I am allowed to place bets.
No, these are theoretical bets we're talking about here.
Yeah, like if I'm not allowed to place bets, then I obviously didn't. Because why would I do anything that I'm not allowed to do?
Yep.
That's crazy, right? But if I am allowed to place bets, the way I go about betting on the Masters is I can only bet for people I want to root for. Because I do not want to sit around on Sunday cheering for people I don't want to actually win.
Wait. Isn't that just how you're supposed to bet in general?
Yeah.
Because that's literally all I do.
Yeah, I bet on Tiger Woods and the Mets.
I
just bet Tiger Woods and the Mets every day.
I do not think I've ever bet anyone that I didn't want to win.
Yeah, I just bet the Mets and the Grizzlies and Tiger Woods. That's all I bet forever my whole life.
You did not the Grizzlies.
Yeah. No, that's not how you're supposed to bet.
No.
But some people do. But I don't want to just like I could go, ooh, man, I really think Bryson DeChambeau is going to be great in Augusta. But then you know what I immediately say after that? The last thing I want to do is spend Sunday rooting for Bryson DeChambeau, that goofy. So no, I'm not involved in that.
Sorry.
So I only I'll throw some on Max Homa and Tony Finau and Rory. Just because I want to root for people. And I don't want to be rooting against my own bets or betting against my own rooting interest. So I just bet with my rooting interest.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure it'll be a loss. But whatever.
Yeah.
It's about the journey. Didn't we learn that yesterday?
Yeah.
It's about the journey.
What?
I'm enjoying the journey right now.
Yeah, I'm enjoying the journey too. I did that. Hey, that Tiger plus 900. I mean, it was screaming to me.
Okay.
Top 10 finish.
Well.
It was screaming to
me. Hey. I promise you, my bosses hope that you win that bet.
Hey.
There is nothing better for CBS than Tiger Woods on TV this weekend.
They told me he looked good in the practice rounds. They said that back doesn't look like an issue, that leg looked really strong.
Well, I hope so.
Uh-huh.
Wouldn't that be something?
It'd be so much fun.
Wouldn't that be great?
Yep.
I mean, the difference between, the difference between having the biggest sporting event of the weekend and just a golf tournament is Tiger Woods.
Yeah. I mean, I think that, like, obviously that's different. But I do think that there are a lot of names in this where, like, if Brooks Koepka's in this towards the end, like, you're going to get a big weekend. You know, if
Brooks, Bryson is a big name.
Yeah. John Rahm, Scotty Scheffler. I think any of those guys,
Jordan Spieth, Justin Day, but nothing compares to Tiger.
No.
Like, nothing.
Not even close.
Nothing. Like we talked about yesterday.
Yeah, I think he's late.
He won't even finish his round.
Right. So he's not going to start until 3 o'clock now.
Yeah.
Because they push everything back.
But who needs me to keep you up on the Masters? We got somebody around here who's better at that than anybody in the whole wide world, right?
Yeah, I'm glad. I think they were nervous about it because of this morning. But it looks like we will get
here's the
Masters
problem. Here's
updates.
The problem with the Chris Vernon show.
Yeah.
You only get your Masters updates on Thursday and Friday.
Mm-hmm.
I've actually wondered if it's worthwhile just how big this thing has gotten.
To bring your ass in studio this weekend.
Yeah. Not that I'm trying to make Vernon and Roser and all them folks work on the weekends, but like that
I'll come up there and press some buttons for y'all.
But hey, Bennett says he'll come produce the Masters updates on the weekends if you need
him. I saw him getting the love yesterday.
Yeah.
He got that little Pat McAfee show bump.
Yeah. No, it's a thing.
Yeah.
It's a thing.
I saw SVP hopping in there saying he's excited.
Yeah, everybody's excited.
I know.
I'm excited.
What do you think they'd be excited about for our show?
Nothing.
I bet SVP's a Five More Things fan.
Mm.
No.
Eh. I mean, I like SVP.
Yeah.
And I think he likes me.
Yeah.
But I don't know. The Masters is a thing in and of itself. The Masters updates are a thing.
I do love those Masters updates. I'm excited, man.
Yeah. No, you can't try to replicate that. You just have to appreciate it.
Yep.
Right?
And it's all its glory.
Yeah, yep. Just appreciate it in all its glory.
I think it's going to be special this
year. So it'd be a real shame. This was the point I was trying to make. It'd be a real shame if weather created a situation where we couldn't have a Masters update today, because then we'd only be limited to one Masters update in the whole year 2024.
No, we can't have
that. At least one day of them.
We can't have
that.
We can't have that.
So thank God. Thank God they're underway down at Augusta.
Yep.
Bryson DeChambeau's your early leader. Vernon, Roser and everybody else over there will be yelling about it in just a bit. I can't wait. Be back. GP's carryout.
Now for a limited time, the new $1.99 crispy tender wraps are here at Sonic. Who could deny a crispy chicken tender with bold flavors like hickory barbecue and cheesy Baja? And we can't forget the crisp lettuce and melty cheese to make the perfect bite. Wrap yourself up with some TLC, tender, love, and chicken for only $1.99. Sonic $1.99 crispy tender wraps. Tax not included, limited time only at participating Sonic drive-ins.
Are you a healthcare professional looking for a new experience? Look no further than Travel Nurses, Inc. Our extensive network of healthcare facilities across the country offers you the opportunity to discover new destinations while pursuing your passion. We provide competitive compensation, flexible contracts, and dedicated assistance. So join our community of nurses and allied health professionals and start your next adventure today. Visit our website at travelnursesinc.com for more information.
Let's face it, there's a lot of trash talk in basketball, but the great teams let their performance do the talking. Like Ford F-150 with Pro Power Onboard, a class-exclusive industry-first feature that turns your truck into a mobile generator and leaves the competition speechless. Ford F-150, official truck of the Grizzlies. Greatness starts here at your Mid-South Ford dealer. Class is full-size pickups under 8,500 pounds, GBWR.
Looking for a full court dining experience? Dribble over to Southland Casino Hotel, your ultimate gaming oasis in West Memphis. As a proud sponsor of the Memphis Grizzlies, we're inviting you to savor the flavors at our 8 incredible dining venues. Ignite Steakhouse is where culinary excellence gets grilled. Indulge in charcoal grilled steaks and farm-to-table favorites, perfectly paired with wine or handcrafted cocktails. Enjoy an all-access buffet experience at the kitchens, or revel in comfort food and southern classics at the front. Pie House. If casual is more your thing, sample the innovative fare at Seasons Cafe, while Chairman's Bar and Charred Oak Bourbon Bar serve up cocktails and live concerts every week. For those on the go, The Grind is your one-stop coffee shop with gourmet brews and grab-and-go goodies. And of course, we can't forget the Sports Bar and Grill, where you can catch all the Grizzlies action with the best pub fare in town. At Southland Casino Hotel, we've got the perfect dining experience for you, so come on down and ignite your taste buds today.
Must be 21 plus. Play responsibly. For help quitting, call 800-522-4700.
Welcome back, Gary Parrish Show, presented by Ortho South. We're inside the Built Ford Tough Studio. Let's wrap it up. GP's carryout.
It's time for GP's carryout. One final segment filled with stuff to take with you. It's not everything you need to know, but it's most of it. What did we learn today?
A whole bunch of stuff, but we mostly focused on the big breaking news of the day. Orenthal James Simpson. And you know, people will always know that OJ stood for Orenthal James because of that trial? Because we've all seen the verdict a million times.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
The defendant, Orenthal James Simpson, not guilty. Orenthal James, OJ, dead at 76, lost a battle with cancer. Typically, people lose battles with cancer. It's a sad day.
Yes.
Are you sad?
I mean, not really.
Can you find it?
I mean, he's an old man. Like, it's not like he was, like, a young man that passed away. I put, like, all the murder stuff aside. Like,
okay.
He's an old guy.
Okay. So, if Robert De Niro dies of cancer tomorrow, you'll just say, he's an old man, whatever.
I'll be sad.
Okay. Why?
I'll be sad that he died of cancer.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you can't find, you're not sad that OJ's out of cancer.
I'm sad when anyone dies of cancer.
Even OJ? I'm not sad.
Okay. Well, you said it. No, I'm finding it hard to find the sadness, I guess.
Yeah, I'm not sad.
Because I think he murdered someone.
Yeah, two people. I think he did two.
I can't prove it.
I can.
Can you? Yes. Do you have proof?
I do have proof. I do have proof.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just a weird thing. You don't know how to talk about it, right?
Yeah, I know.
That's why I asked you that, just to see what you would say.
Uh-huh.
Because people don't know what to say. Usually when famous people die, you go, oh, that's so sad. But then this guy is an alleged murderer. So is it sad? How you juggle that?
Life's a strange mystery.
It's tough, you know?
Yeah.
You know? That's somebody's dad.
That's true.
Somebody's dad died today.
Yeah, you're right.
You know what?
You're
it's absolutely sad when people like that happens to people, you know?
Yeah.
Typically, somebody's dad dies, you go, oh man, I'm so sorry. That was so-and-so's dad, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you don't care that somebody's dad died today. It doesn't make you sad.
I can be sad about that.
Right.
Yeah, I'm sad about that.
I always was fascinated by the idea that his kids stood by him for the most part. Would you? Could you?
I mean, you know,
if you believed your dad, if the whole world believed your dad killed your mom, but he was found not guilty of it, could you have a relationship with your father?
I think you see this a lot in these kind of situations, like the Murdaughs, Buster's
right
in court with his dad every day during that trial.
Right.
And it's, you know, it's pretty clear that that he killed his other son and his wife. And was charged of it. The Lorenzen Wright thing, right? Like that, I mean, her.
Those kids still apparently stand by
their
mother.
Have a relationship with their mother who, you know.
That's why I'm always hesitant to say there's no way, because I see enough people. I promise you, all those people thought there's no way too.
Right.
But then there's too many examples of people who have blind spots for this stuff that you can't rule out that you might too.
Yeah.
Because I bet you if you ever told Buster Murdaugh, could you imagine? What if your dad killed your mom and your brother?
Mm-hmm.
Could you imagine still having a relationship with him? He's like, are you crazy? But then there he is. You know?
Yeah.
So I think it's easy to look at these people and go, what is wrong with you? Your dad killed your mom and you're like still but like too many people stand by their parents in weird stuff like that, that it makes me like, there's gotta be something that leads you to a place you thought you'd never be.
Mm-hmm.
What a wild situation that must be.
That, yeah.
Let's just hope. This
has got to be tough to grapple
with. Let's just hope none of us find ourselves in that situation, you know?
I will hope so.
Let's just hope we don't ever find ourselves in that situation.
Yeah.
Orenthal James Simpson, dead at 76.
What's today's biggest game?
Bennett?
Oh, I hate doing this. I hate this now.
I'm gonna tell
you. I used to love the biggest game of the night. It was one of my favorite parts of the show.
You're just not good at it, you know?
Apparently not. Apparently not.
Just not good at it.
Yeah.
Knicks Celtics tonight on TNT. It's a 6:30 tip.
Great.
TD Garden up at Boston, Massachusetts. Knicks are 2.5-point favorites on the road. Boston must have decided nobody's playing ever again until the playoffs.
Yeah.
Total 215.5. How are you going to act?
Knicks are what, two? Did you say two?
And a half.
Two and a half. I don't like those halves. I do not like those halves. Those bother me. You know, the Knicks are still right there with the Cavs. You don't want to get jumped. You want to keep that three seed, I think. So I'm going to go reluctantly with your New York Knickerbockers.
Big Bet Bennett says take the Knicks -2.5 in Boston. If he wins it, he'll only be down 22.1 units. If he loses it, he'll be down 24.2 units. So either way, we're still going to be in a bad spot, but one's better than the other. So that's what we're rooting for.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What are we watching on TV?
How about the OJ Made in America documentary? Shouldn't we revisit
that? I think so.
That?
I'm going to revisit it.
Yeah.
I want to watch it again now.
Yeah, if you watch it again, you know how great it is. If you've never watched it again, just trust us. It's one of the greatest documentaries ever made. Just incredible. Incredible filmmaking. On a day like today, maybe if you're looking for something, go try that.
Yeah. What's the best thing we've read?
Chris Trapasso over at CBS Sports has his latest NFL mock draft listed on the homepage. Number one pick to the Chicago Bulls. You know what they're doing, don't you? Caleb Williams.
Yep. The Bears.
What did I say?
I think the Bulls would probably want Caleb Williams right now, too.
The Bulls would take Caleb Williams.
Yeah, they'd take him.
The Bears would, too, though.
Yeah.
But the Bulls probably would, too.
Yep.
Caleb Williams, first pick to the Chicago Bears. You a believer?
You know, I'm not so sure. I'm not so sure. They clearly have a conviction about it, which makes me feel a little more sure because, again, you had a quarterback there that I think still has potential to be a decent quarterback in this league in Justin Fields, and they were ready to move off of him pretty quickly. So, yeah, I think that probably shows smarter people than I know that there's something really there with Caleb Williams.
Hey, we'll find out.
Yeah.
We'll find out. Mock draft up. Find it on the homepage, CBSSports.com.
What's on tap for tomorrow?
Well, it'll be Friday. King's coming to town.
The King is coming to town. I hope so. You got to play.
Got to play.
You guys got something to play for.
King's coming to town.
Yeah. That's always fun.
It ain't every day that the King comes to town.
I love it.
King's coming to town. So that's.
Although, I got to sit next to Vernon and Roser, and that's tough. I wish you were up there with us to help me.
I would appreciate.
Because it's like every time he's here and I got to sit next to them at the game, it's just a constant bashing I have to take and belittling.
I believe I'm going to take the family.
Are you?
I think so. I think I would like the family to see the King.
Okay.
You never know when it's going to be your last time to see a King.
Yeah. You never know.
You never know.
It won't be the last time.
You never know.
That's true.
You never know.
Yeah, he could go to the East next year and only be here once and sit that game, right?
You never know.
It's true. You're right.
OJ Simpson's dead, Bennett.
Right.
You never know.
You're right.
See what I'm saying?
You're right.
So I think I'm going to take family to the King tomorrow. Never know when it'll be your last time to see a King. I bet you the last time you saw OJ, you didn't think that was the last time you were going to see OJ.
I didn't really think about it.
See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You never know.
No, I'm always here for greatness. We will be seated.
I can't wait.
Mm-hmm.
Enjoy the rest of your day. I'm going to enjoy mine. Meet back here tomorrow at 10. Till then, be careful, be kind, be good. Rep your hood.